Could you maybe expand on more so the myth that if not for discrimination, society would have equal representation in careers, income, education, and incarceration? Because that's the huge main tenet of leftism that's taught on campus. If not for discrimination, we'd all have these equal representation outcomes.
You put your finger on the key assumption on which the whole, it's like the keystone that holds up the whole structure, and you remove that and they don't have very much. age is one of those things, but what people desire to do matters.
Right.
For all I know, I might have been born, you know, with genes that would have enabled me to become another Rudolf Nureyev as a male ballet dancer.
Okay.
If I was, it was a total waste of genes. Right. Because where I grew up, nobody ever thought about, no guy has ever thought about becoming male ballet dancers. So it doesn't matter what their abilities were. It doesn't matter whether there was opposition or the gates of opportunity were wide open. They weren't going to become male ballet dancers. But what people want to do is huge.
Right.
And you look, for example, I mean, why are there no Asian American basketball players? Because they don't want to play basketball.
Height plays a factor as well there?
It might, but again, with age, you don't find Japanese Americans as baseball stars.
Right.
There have been baseball stars of Japanese ancestry. Every one of them was born in Japan. They were not Japanese Americans.
Right. Yeah.
And when more you look into either people or nature, you find disparities everywhere, all over the world, and all kinds of things. And yet, when you come to people's talk, the talk is about how everything would be even. Let me throw another one in, just to nail the point. Geography. You know, people who live up in mountains on any continent are not the same as people who live in river valleys. The people in river valleys almost invariably have higher incomes, more education. They're more advanced. The people in the mountains tend to lag behind. One study was done, coastal people seem to be far more prosperous than people that live inland. Mm. One study pointed out that something like 8% of the world's population lived on coasts in the temperate zone. But they produce something like, it's 8% of the land is like that.
Yeah.
But 23% of the world's population lives there, and they produce 53% of the world's output. I mean, the circumstances matter hugely, and those circumstances are almost never the same for everybody.
That's very interesting, you know, that you bring that up. I would wonder if we would talk about that, the economic disparity of the coastal cities. There's sort of that legacy wealth, because back in the day, before technology, you had to be on the coast, right, for mainline shipping. Any kind of, if you want to do any international commerce. And again, that's one thing, you could look at it as geography, or you could look at it from some kind of economic standpoint. You know, something that was really telling to me when we were just talking about socialism, and I'm sure you're familiar with this, you just talked about geography. When we talk about Denmark and these Norwegian countries, and we talk about their economic status, one thing that's often not mentioned is actually Swedish. It's true, they do better than the average American, but Swedish Americans, Danish Americans on average have a 55% higher lifestyle, not life expectancy. What's the word I'm looking for here?
Life expectancy.
I'm trying to think of what's the word. See, with Thomas Sowell, I get nervous. Quality of life. Quality of life. 55% higher quality of life on average than the Danes in Denmark. And that's something that, again, would throw everyone for a loop when you bring that up. And it's very easily found.
Yes. Yes. No, in a previous book, I went into these geographic differences, and they're just astonishing. And sometimes it takes just one. Discrimination and Disparities book, in the first chapter, I go into the fact that the firstborn child does so much better than the laterborn children.
Yeah.
And here you have both the heredity and the environment is the same as these are normally defined, and yet you find a complete overrepresentation of firstborn children and of the only child in so many areas. One strikes me at once is astronauts. The Apollo astronauts who got a man on the moon, 29 of them, 22 of them were either firstborn or an only child.
Why is that? Do we have any sort of causation?
We don't fully know, but I make the argument and show some evidence that it's the parental input, because the only kind of child that does better than the firstborn is the only child. Hmm. And what he gets that the others don't get is full parental attention. The firstborn is an only child for a while.
Yeah.
So I think that's crucial. Also, if you look at twins average several points lower IQ than people who are born singly. And yet those where one of the twins is stillborn or dies early, then the other one has an IQ not very different from those of people who are born singly. So parental input is just huge.
Yeah.
And that varies enormously from group to group.
Yeah, it is fascinating. I believe my producer has a question.
What you're saying is that would mean that the first few years of someone's life are incredibly formative. Because that's the only period of time they live without another sibling.
Would live as an only child. It would seem.
So,
I mean, again,
they're equally two children of the parents who have to split time once.
Do you think that's a big reason why, Mr. Soul, the formative years early on?
Oh yes. In fact, in doing the research, I thought of my own life. Had my parents lived out a normal life, I would have been the sixth child in the family. They both died young.
Oh, wow.
I was raised from infancy as an only child in a family of four adults. A complete, huge difference from what would have been otherwise.
Well,
so it was their great misfortune and my good fortune.